Fellows, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, can you hear me? You're at the cheap seats at the back, can you hear me? Good. I'm John Lewis, General Secretary of the Society of Antiquaries of London, and I'd like to welcome you to the Society's apartments at Burlington House. We are the country's oldest learned society concerned with researching and caring for the remains of the past, but we're not solely an archaeological society. We cover all aspects of the study of the past through its material remains. So that means we have art historians, architectural historians, heralds, archivists. In fact, I won't name all of them because if I leave some of them out, they get quite upset. Nonetheless, the Society has a long history of association with the Palaeolithic, with perhaps one of the most famous examples being John Frere's letter on hand axes from Hoxton, published in Archaeologia in 1800. This article contained the words, of course, fabricated and used by people who had not the use of metals and coming from a very remote period indeed. And this is Archaeologia from 1800. Now that is the article based on the letter that was read out a few years before at one of our Thursday meetings. And until recently we had one of those hand axes up in the fellows room, which we'll have to get back on display. Before I go further, some housekeeping points. Fire, there are no fire drill scheduled for today, so if the alarm goes off, then please everybody exit through that door in an orderly fashion and go out through the main door into the courtyard, and if you all congregate round the statue of Sir Joshua Reynolds, where you will be given further instruction. Toilets, those of you who haven't been here before, the gents are through that door left and left again, and the ladies are again through the door left, right, and go all the way down to the end of the corridor through the door, and they're right at the end. One other thing about today is we've got a lot of speakers, so please could everybody stick to time, he says, starting a few minutes late. That clock up there is actually about 5 minutes fast. Now, I spent my career from 1984 to 2010 as a commercial field archaeologist and a project manager, who was also a prehistorian. I am not a Palaeolithic specialist, but from time to time, circumstances meant that I was involved with Palaeolithic archaeology. Each time a Palaeolithic, and dare I mention the word Mesolithic, site turned up, I was always struck by the huge advances that had been made in our understanding of the period since the last project had cropped up several years before. The Lost Landscapes volume that we will celebrate later today perfectly captures the incredible advances that have been made in that time. And I think it's rather like watching our children grow up. We didn't really sort of notice our children getting bigger and growing up, but our relatives who saw them less frequently every time they'd visit, they would always say, gosh, haven't they grown? And I think, if you sort of come in and out of the period, you realise just how things change and change quite rapidly in the time, certainly when I was an archaeologist. Today's conference arose from a proposal by two fellows, which is always the best way we like to do conferences, Matt Pope and Clive Gamble. They proposed a conference to discuss threats posed to the gains made in our understanding and practice of Palaeolithic archaeology post-TURPS and PBG16. At a time of enormous financial and political pressure on the enabling mechanisms for commercial and research archaeology in England. This struck a chord with us at the Society because we've been concerned about the wider issue of how local government spending cuts are weakening the mechanisms for protecting and investigating heritage resources, which are increasingly threatened by a political imperative to facilitate development. As far back as the View from the Battlements conference held here in Burlington House in 2011, it was clear that the present patchwork system of archaeological provision with local authorities would be under threat. In July 2013, the Society hosted a debate at Burlington House on behalf of the Archaeology Forum on local government archaeological provision. The debate is on our website and YouTube, and it's rather interesting watching. This debate gave rise to the Reedsdale-Howell inquiry into provision of archaeological advice to local government. Unfortunately, the report still hasn't been published. However, the Society's evidence, again, which is on our website, to the inquiry, clearly set out that we believe that there is an opportunity for radical reform of the entire system and a move to provision of archaeological advice at a regional level with regional statutory HERs linked to form a single national historic environment record. As we are seeing in certain areas of England, there are already ad hoc moves to regionalise provision, or indeed lack of provision, driven by local government spending cuts rather than a planned transformation based on archaeological needs and considerations of public engagement. The Society is therefore happy to host a conference which explores how a period-focused archaeological discipline addresses changing policy frameworks and methodological practices, challenges which are also facing the rest of English archaeology. If there are trends, issues, and most importantly, solutions that emerge from today that are more broadly applicable, then the conference will not only have been good for Palaeolithic archaeology, but the practice of archaeology of all periods in England. So, enough of me, and I will hand over to the chair of the first session, Professor Danielle Schreve. Danielle.
Right. Good morning, everybody. It gives me great pleasure to chair the first session of this conference, and indeed no more appropriate venue could we find than the Society of Antiquaries for this particular meeting. So the format for these sessions will be that each speaker is given up to 15 minutes to make their presentations, and that will be followed by a panel discussion. So if I could ask you in the audience to hold your questions until that panel discussion, and then we'll open the floor to questions. So the first session is New Horizons in the British Palaeolithic, and we have three speakers who will be presenting their own views on where we've got to, and indeed what new horizons lie ahead. So it gives me pleasure to ask the first speaker to come up. That's Nick Ashton from the British Museum, and he will be talking on behalf also of his co-authors, Simon Parfitt and Simon Lewis. Over to you, Nick.
Thank you, and good morning. I'm not sure where the title came from, but I imagined that it was meant to push me in the direction of talking about some of the earlier sites that we've been discovering, mainly around the coast. As most of you are probably aware, over the last 15 years, there have been huge changes in our understanding of the earliest humans in Northern Europe. And most of this has been concentrated on sites in Norfolk and Suffolk, particularly around the coast, where huge coastal erosion is bringing up new information all the time. So the talk is really going to be focused on those areas, and it's involved a large number of people, and the two most significant, I think, are Simon Lewis and Simon Parfitt, so I'm speaking on their behalf. One of the main sites that was first discovered in 2000 was the site of Pakefield, and I won't say anything really about that, but I want to really concentrate on the work that's been taking place around Haysborough. And in fact, we now know that we've probably got five different sites, one of which you'll see is out to sea. That's not the actual location of the site, it's probably somewhere further east than that, and we're still really trying to locate it. This is some of the work that's been going on to try and locate where site five with colleagues Justin Dix, Fraser Sturt, and Rachel Bino. And I've promised Rachel an extra 5 minutes later on in the afternoon to give her the 5 minutes to talk more about that work. Moving on very quickly, it's really just to summarise some of the findings. Haysborough Site 1, that was again discovered in 2000. We worked there 2004, and then with the Dutch team from Leiden between 2009 and 2012, I think. This site, we think, dates to about 500,000. It contains hand axes, also contains cut-marked bone. But the site of real focus has been Haysborough Site 3, and this has really extended our time range back, we think, to either 850,000 years or possibly even 950,000 years. So this has extended the time range of humans in Northern Europe, not just Norfolk or Suffolk or Britain, but Northern Europe, by a staggering at least 350,000 years. So this really has changed one of our main parameters to work with. And associated with the site is a simple flake and core industry, a few flake tools, and an amazing range of environmental information that allows us to ask questions about human habitats. And associated with those deposits were the footprints that were first discovered with Martin Bates and his brother Richard and Simon, or both Simons, back in 2013. These were published the following year. So these are the earliest human footprints outside Africa. It's not really that work that I want to concentrate on, but it's really a project part funded by English Heritage, or Historic England, as we now call it. And this was both a monitoring program and a program to try and understand better the onshore-offshore links between the sediments that we're finding. Very briefly on the monitoring project, we've had a certain amount of success in trying to engage local collectors. We've held fossil road shows, and there are two particular individuals, Darren and Joe Nicholas, who really should be here today actually, who've discovered by going down twice weekly, not only are they reporting back new deposits that are emerging, but they're also collecting amazing quantities of artifacts and fossils, not just from Haysborough, but from a range of sites along that stretch of coast. And just taking Haysborough alone, we found 80 artifacts through 400 metre squares of excavation, and they found a staggering 159, most of which are on the surface, but almost certainly coming from those same deposits. That particular part of the project has worked very well, but we do need to continue working on ways of monitoring these coastlines in a better way. None of us have got the time to be up there constantly, so we need to engage the local collectors, the local population, to report those finds back. This is beginning to emerge in this way, and we've equipped these particular pair with a camera with GPS, so we have both a photographic record and a location for the finds that have been discovered. The other part of the work, in fact the main part of the work, has been a programme of geophysics. I've just talked to Martin Bates, who sat at the back now, and his brother Richard. They covered an astonishing 20 kilometres transects in the Haysborough area. Alongside that, to ground truth those geophysical transects, none of which I really understand, so if there are any questions on that, I'm sure Martin can answer them later. There's been an extensive coring programme, and I think our own coring work, 34 new cores have been put down, some from the cliff top, some on the beach, some with greater success than others, but staggering 34 boreholes. This is with Simon Lewis and Peter Hoare, and with both these methods we've got a better idea of the distribution of the channel systems that are coming out at Haysborough. This is a map put together by Simon Lewis, and you can see the two channel systems. This is above site 3, quite a wide channel we think, and this is above site 1, a much narrower channel. So we've got some idea of where they're heading inland and where the threat is likely to be in the future. Perhaps of even greater interest is the estimates of where the coastline will be in subsequent years. So we've taken, or Simon's taken, historic mapping, current day mapping, Google Earth imagery to show where the coastline is today and where it has been in the past. But there's also a shoreline management plan that was published, I think, in 2007, which shows their estimates of where the coastline will be in 2030, 2055, and 2105. I imagine none of us will be around to see that. Hope not, anyway. And that in itself provides a way of thinking about how we deal with these coastline sediments, and I think this is particularly informative. Again, this was put together by Simon Lewis. It shows the areas that have been eroded during particular time periods. So you can see between 1890 and 1994, virtually nothing by comparison to what was happening in subsequent years. And the important thing, I think, for the future is if you take the period 2015 to 2030, and these are obviously the next 14 years, the actual erosion over the Site 1 area that's under threat seems to be, based on these figures, comparatively small. But for Site 3, it's immense. And this really, I think, highlights where we need to put our resources in the future and think of ways of dealing with this resource in probably better ways, you know, and I think this is, you know, a discussion that can be had with the panel later on. Just to provide slightly wider context, beyond Hosfield, Hosfield is one small dot on the map. And we've got the whole of that coastline to think about. And the black areas around that coastline show where the chromophorous bed deposits, the deposits that we're dealing with, extend around the coast. I think understanding those sequences is highly important for understanding where human evidence is likely to be. So there's a huge amount of work to be done beyond the immediate site of Hosfield. And these deposits have the potential to answer questions, I think, of global importance. These are the first human adaptations to northern environments. How did humans deal with long, cold winters? What sort of technologies did they have? Did they have clothing? Did they have shelter? Did they have fire? Were they physically adapted? These are questions of global importance, and I think we need to recognise that around that coastline, we can potentially answer some of those questions. So just to give you that global perspective, they're the earliest sites in northern Europe, unique organic preservation that allows you to reconstruct human habitats in a way that is very rare, insights into earliest human adaptations, and these are sites of global interest. And there's plenty more to do. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Nick. So, I mean, in contrast to what we're seeing on the coast, where erosion's doing a pretty efficient job of exposing the deposits of interest, what we're now going to do is to travel further inland to consider the record of the Palaeolithic resource from fluvial deposits, and then to think about that in the context of exposures that have been made, for example, through our long history of aggregates extraction and major construction projects. So our next speaker will be Rob Hosfield from Reading University, and Rob will be talking about the records from the English rivers, contextualising the resource.
Okay, I don't think I really need to say a great deal about perhaps even what the fluvial archive is, why it's important. It's obviously a very rich mix of sediments, of biological material, of hominin material culture, which tell us an awful lot about paleogeography, chronology, habitats and climate, human presence and absence, human behaviour through all phases of the Palaeolithic. It's perhaps particularly significant for the earlier Palaeolithic, the lower and the middle, but it is not unsignificant for the upper Palaeolithic as well. I think the reasons it is such a significant resource is that we can stress, in the majority of cases really, the continuity of these river landscapes. There are one or two notable exceptions, but in the main they provide this sort of long-standing way of focusing on landscape, whether it's in the pre-Anglian or into the later Middle Pleistocene through, as illustrated there, to the late Glacial. And it gives us, therefore, this very wide spatio-temporal resource, gives us lots of windows into the Palaeolithic, different places at different times, to look at fluvial landscapes and think about their composition and human behaviour associated with them. And thanks, of course, to the appreciations that in particular developed, or perhaps it's better to say redeveloped, in the 1980s and the 1990s, an understanding of how river landscapes form and adjust in response both to climate change but also to uplift. And that was classically demonstrated, particularly in the 1990s, by David Bridgeland, as illustrated here. Which raises the question, is there anything else we need to know about rivers and how they behave? To which the polite answer is, of course there is. Because what we've actually come to see over the last 15 to 20 years is how diverse these river landscapes are in terms of their behaviour and how they respond. So, for example, you can have variable separation between the terraces in different reaches of rivers. Contrast here the lower Thames with the vertical separation of the terraces, the old floodplains in the Middle Thames. Or we can have examples where the same climatic stages are represented in the same terraces, but we can equally have examples where the same climatic stages are represented in multiple terraces. And there are variations in the numbers of terraces that form in response to climate cycles. Or indeed, we can have examples where there's very little preservation of the river record because of local geological conditions and later erosion. Fine, why does any of that matter? Because, of course, it has huge impacts for understanding artifact contexts, issues of reworking, alleged periods of human presence and absence, and understanding this background is critical to that. As with developing understanding of how varied rivers are and the way that they evolve and change in terms of landscapes, has been our increasing appreciation of river chronology. And again, over perhaps the last decade, two decades, we've seen major developments in terms of new methods or more effectively applied methods, optically stimulated luminescence, amino acid racemization. A number of key methods are providing us with other ways of establishing the chronology of these deposits, these river landscapes, and their associated archaeology. Again, are there things to do? Absolutely. More work to be done, I think, in comparisons between different methods. For example, between OSL, which over the last few years has had very heavy usage on this side of the channel, with, say, the ESR, electron spin resonance method, which has had perhaps more application over in France and elsewhere. To what extent can we achieve substage resolution in terms of our dating methods? It's increasingly clear to us how variable past climate was within, you know, big glacials. Can we pick up that with dating resolution? The other, perhaps another key element of this resource is the biological material. And again, many colleagues in this room, enormous strides have been made in terms of understanding biostratigraphy, key biological associations of both macro and microfauna. Again, I think there are interesting questions moving forward. To what extent might we be able to pick up substage resolution in terms of biological material? Quite often when we look at Pleistocene biology, it looks slightly odd. People have written about strange associations of this animal and that animal. Well, in a river context, an interesting question for us to ask is that genuine? Or is it a product of rivers washing things together and producing these strange associations, which aren't actually strange at all, they're just a big jumble? Or are they real? Now, in terms of understanding Palaeolithic ecology, the worlds in which hominins lived, that seems pretty critical. And similarly, of course, many other aspects of the biological record, all those wonderful small critters of various forms that give us remarkable detail about past climates, summer temperature estimates, winter temperature estimates, all these different things. And again, I think there's an interesting question, can those biological proxies combined with sedimentological data, can they reveal abrupt climate change? Can we pick that up in these records? And how do these different proxies integrate? Their differences in terms of their sensitivity to climate change, lag times in their responses, how do those vary, and what are the implications of those variations for environmental reconstruction? Right, so I've said nothing about archaeology so far. I thought I'd do it this way around. I suppose I'd better mention it at some point. The obvious point, of course, with the river records is that just occasionally we get that wonderful high-resolution archaeology, the in-situ or the little moved, the little disturbed, and that might reveal to us in-situ surfaces, stone tool evidence of human behaviour, footprints, as also shown by Nick, animal remains, the associations between stone and bone. And these, of course, are absolutely critical, these moments in time in terms of, particularly when combined with paleo-environmental associations, helping us to understand early human environmental tolerances, some of those themes that Nick was concluding with at the end of his presentation. But of course, this high-resolution archaeology is pretty thin on the ground, as illustrated. Oh, there was a suitable cautionary note about using the pointer. I think the key caution is about turn it around and show it all at you. But as shown here, the numbers of in-situ sites that we have, very few and far between, and actually quite biased to this southeastern corner. And so, of course, it's very much the case that it is the low-resolution archaeology, the accumulations of artefacts that have been reworked, washed down river, that dominate our archaeological record. But there is much scope to use this archaeology to give us those broader perspectives, whether it's settlement history models, the work in particular of Nick Ashton and Simon Lewis a few years ago now, or thinking about possible patterning in material culture, for example, Mark White's work looking at possible hand axe trends through time in the Lower Paleolithic. But again, as with this, as with other forms of evidence, there are a number of knowledge issues here. Some of our key collections remain very poorly contextualised. We have the artefacts, we don't necessarily know all that much about the context from which they came. We're sometimes pretty hazy on their age, for example. And there's a key need here for both understanding the history of past research, whether that's gravel quarrying, for example, but also the application of new technologies. Deposit modelling springs to mind, whether done at the site scale or at the landscape or regional scale. And we might also recognise that there are lots of blanks or poorly well understood areas on our maps. So in this case, these are the various fine spots and sites for the Lower and Middle Paleolithic. There's somewhere in the region of about 3,500 of them, hence all the overlapping triangles. And well, there's a few gaps in there. Thanks, Dan. Okay. So, things we might want to think about. There are examples where we've come to know particular fluvial river landscapes extremely well. And in many cases, that understanding has come through lots and lots of small interventions, small projects, small bits of work that have accumulated over time to develop this much bigger understanding. And Francis and many others' work in northwest Kent springs to mind here. Do we want to keep doing that in the current context? Should we keep doing it? If we do, do we need to advocate very strongly why each of those small individual interventions is important? Because it contributes to that much bigger picture. Secondly, do we always need to know more? Controversial thought, possibly. So for example, speaking from my own part of the world, Reading, do we need a few more rolled hand axes from the Boyne Hill terrace gravels of the Middle Thames? I'm tempted to suggest possibly not. Thirdly, what matters in the Paleolithic river record? I think because, in particular, because we have so many perhaps poorly contextualised collections, old collections, sometimes we need an understanding of sediments, of biology, of dating, much more than we need more artefacts. Fourthly, can we, should we, how do we justify new projects, new interventions in areas that look blank on the map? In short, how do we say to someone, I'd really like money to go and look in this place where no one's found anything before? Can you guarantee finding anything? Well, but actually, understanding those blanks better, I would suggest, is really terribly important in terms of a more holistic understanding of Paleolithic landscapes and Paleolithic people. And finally, thinking about a more holistic understanding, I'll throw out the thought, just occasionally, are we a bit too focused on rivers? And I will end with the thought that, like Mr. Toad, perhaps we might benefit from a short period of leaving the riverbank behind us for a while and exploring more broadly before maybe returning sometime in the future. Thank you.
Thanks, Rob. I'm all for having some research questions steered by a variety of small and medium-sized mammals. Right. I think, as Rob has very well illustrated, we are blessed in Britain with a fantastic fluvial record, but maybe there is obviously an opportunity that perhaps we've not capitalised on fully to look at other areas, different types of Pleistocene sedimentary deposition on the landscape, and particularly to think about the record from the plateaus and how we might try to pinpoint where sites are likely to be preserved. So our final speaker in this session is Beccy Scott from the British Museum. And Becky's title is actually one that is going to take us away. Whoops, we don't want optimal resolution notification. Thank you very much. I think it is optimally resolved now. And Becky is going to incorporate a rather wider perspective in this regard. Her title is The Palaeolithic Record of the Plateau, a Trans-Manche Perspective.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Rob, for possibly the greatest setup I could possibly have had, because I'm going to move us straight on to the rolling downs and actually talk about capture outside of the river valleys, from which we have an exceptional record that our entire discipline really to date has been focused upon compiling and interrogating, and actually start to think a little bit more about how we can build up more holistic pictures of how humans are using these landscapes. So historically, of course, there's been a lot of work focused, not least of all through the late lamented ALSF projects, upon better understanding, better interrogating the fluvial resource, which is very, very well mapped and well contextualised, and is, you know, really the base data upon which the discipline is founded. But there's a problem with always looking in the same places and using the same data. A lot of our questions become self-fulfilling. If you're talking about habitat preference or preferred vegetation and things like that, if you're always looking at fluvial contexts, you're only ever seeing humans occupying river valleys. So you're getting a very, very skewed picture of where people are and how they're moving around. So to look at broader patterns of land use, by relying on our fluvial resource in isolation, we're actually only telling half the story. And I think this has a knock-on effect in how this feeds into development control situations, in that there's a broad perception that only fluvial deposits have any potential of containing Palaeolithic material, which is almost a sort of self-fulfilling prophecy. If you're only called upon to look where we already know stuff is, then we're just going to see the same picture amplified, if anything. Another thing about this emphasis on the river valleys is that when we start taking a more joined up perspective, working with our French colleagues on understanding their contiguous landscapes, which were at one point linked across the southern North Sea and through where is now the Strait of Dover, we have an imbalanced record. As I hope David Harrison's going to flag up earlier, a lot of the sites that are found in development control contexts in northern France actually come from the plateau and from capture points on the chalk plateau. So our picture looks very, very different to theirs because we're not looking in the same sorts of places. I want to flag something up that I'm perhaps referring to as the clay with flints problem. We've known since at least the 1940s and Testa's work that there's a lot of material coming from the chalk downland, but this is often described as material from the clay with flints or from deposits mapped as clay with flints. I think this has led to people taking their eye off the ball a little bit in terms of where this material is actually coming from. The geology isn't important. What's important is the processes of how this archaeology is being captured and released within these uplands. And actually, we need to be understanding that the landscape taphonomy of the chalk and how material is being captured on the chalk in more detail, not simply being driven by find spots and where people are recovering material, but actually seeking to understand this landscape and its geomorphological evolution in order to understand where people are. And actually, interestingly, one of the things that the clay with flints does do is it keys us into to where the chalk is intact. Where you've still got clay with flints capping the chalk, you haven't got erosion through that cover into the chalk. So you're looking at fairly intact pieces of the upland landscape, but still how stuff is captured within ephemeral points within that is a totally different question. In terms of capture, something else that we need to understand better is actually patterns of lerce distribution within southern England and especially East Kent in comparison with the excellent record that we've got on the continent. So we do have deep sequences of regional lerce, as in northern France, you know, they tend to date to the Devensian. In terms of regional lerce fall, much, much more shallow than deposition across the continent, but it's still there, as in this beautiful section from Pegwell Bay in Thanet. Interestingly, these are things that have effects on where you find stuff within France. So generally, lerce deposition on north-facing slopes. Lerce tends to be rare before MIS6 and is only captured within the same sort of ephemeral points that I'm going to talk about a little bit more here. So you're only seeing this older lerce on the continent where we have deep capture. These processes of solution are going on the chalk in Britain in exactly the same way. So we have the potential for deeper, older sequences that not only can be associated with Palaeolithic archaeology, but also perhaps could start to tie our record away from the river valleys into the regional stratigraphy of lerce pedostratigraphy that's been built up over a long time on the continent. Something people come up with a lot when you start talking about these patterns is that this is only a French phenomenon. We haven't got the lerce that we see in northern France. This simply isn't true, and sites like Caddington flag this up in particular. So this is a doline or series of dolines, sort of an uvula sort of type situation, within which Worthington Smith recovered nests of flake, refitting nests of flake associated with fine-grained deposits, you know, described as a brick earth, but probably with a significant lercic component. And then turning to the North Downs, which is where I grew up, and actually what got me interested in the Palaeolithic in the first place, you've got a lot of fine spots across this area of the Downs in comparison with other parts of the North Downs, but this is very much driven by local interest. So you have a particular local group, Dover Archaeological Group, who are adept at spotting material on the chalk and logging it. And then we've got a very good distribution of material here, which when excavated, as in sort of limited work that we did with Mark White at Westcliff and also at Finglesham, sort of closer to it, tends to be associated with subsurface capture. This isn't one system. There's not one way in which material is being captured like this. There's all sorts of different ways in which these dolines, these sinkholes are forming, and we need to understand the evolution of this landscape more generally, but also within particular sites. And I think a focus on a site-driven micro approach to excavation is not the way to go. We're losing, you know, the wood from the trees doing that. Actually, on a broad scale, we need to understand these landscape processes. And thinking about this on a broad scale, things that are now easily available, you know, like LIDAR, actually show up a lot of these hollows, a lot of these capture points in ways that weren't always easily possible, even just working from air photographs. So things that I think we can start to look at are likely places for capturing these landscapes in terms of where the lurs is coming on, in terms of landscape evolution, where you're likely to get capture, where you're likely to have solution hollow formation, and then opportunities for release. I mean, some interesting points about this part of the country is actually there's very little opportunity for development or anything to impact upon the top of the scarps boat. There's not a lot goes on there apart from farming, apart from in specific situations. The roads tend to run along the base of the scarp, so if people aren't actively prospecting up on the downs, you're just not seeing that material. And this is something that Leslie Blundell, who's a PhD student at UCL, is working on at the moment. The chalk's not the only upland geology in which there's potential for this sort of material being captured. There are other parts of the landscape that we need to understand better, one of which is the Wealden geologies, especially the Folkestone beds, within which you get these fissures opening up as at Item, which captured Pleistocene fauna, but also with Matt's work at Beedings here. But also the slope deposits themselves, reworked from the Folkestone beds, are very, very fine and act in particular instances as around Oldbury to capture Palaeolithic archaeology. And then moving further afield, and I think Chantel will talk about this later, you know, you have situations like Glaston where you have capture up on the upslope within a sort of graben formed as a result of the evolution of that landscape. So just to summarise, I think we need to look away from simply focusing on a fine spot driven perspective and to think about opportunities for capture and erosion of landscape on a wider scale to actually create an integrated upland sort of story. It's a similar, if not the same, Cretaceous landscape as northern France, and there's ways in which we can look to northern France not as an exemplar and not as a model, but as a way of starting to think through our record and the sorts of process that are going on. And this is something that needs evaluating in a regional, on a regional scale within different geomorphological regions, and something that needs ground truthing through field work. So we understand the rivers very, very well. To understand the uplands, we need to start working within these landscapes and doing the baseline work in terms of dating, ground truthing and hypothesis testing in terms of how are these forming to really start to understand our record better. I'll leave it there.
Okay, thank you very much, Beccy. All our speakers have kept admirably to time, which means that we've got plenty of time for the panel discussion now. So it would be helpful if Nick, Rob and Beccy could come up and then we can get some questions in from the audience initially. Oh, time for water. Right. Okay. Do we have any questions from the audience first off? Don't be shy. My goodness. Stunned silence. Yes. Oh, okay. I'll let Renee wander around with the microphone. There we go. Nick.
More a comment than anything else. I just a brief comment to say that please don't forget the Upper Palaeolithic.
That was going to be a question.
All the speakers this morning have been concentrating very much, of course, on the magnificent finds of the Lower and Middle Palaeolithic. But I think also a more serious comment is that we've only really just begun to look at the river valleys, oddly enough, in terms of late glacial archaeology. And therefore, you know, to a certain extent, we don't want to send out the wrong message that everything is understood about river valleys. It may well be from the perspective of terrace formation and chronology, but I can certainly say in relation to, you know, the Upper Palaeolithic, some of the late glacial stuff that's beginning to turn up in river valleys, for example, the Wey Valley, the connections it provides, you know, between locations. So in fact, it's not just one site, I agree with you fully there, one that needs to look at the whole landscape of sites. But actually, the river valleys are very important in providing connections across late glacial landscapes. Where I would agree, certainly, is the question of looking at the Lursic formations, and don't forget the cover sands in Lincolnshire and further north, which actually fulfil the same sort of thing for us stratigraphically. A lot of material is actually stratified beneath that, and it's very, very important, and planners need to be made aware of this.
And of course, there's that whole area of brick earths, you know, around Batchild, Ospringe, in Kent, you know, that is all likely of that date. You know, there's, you know, there's true lurs within that, and impacts upon it, you know, at various points, you know, for heritage brick extraction, almost as much as anything else.
Thanks, Nick. I think that's a very important point. I don't know if any of our speakers here particularly want to elaborate on the Upper Pal record. We're shaking our heads. No? Okay. Yes, go for it.
I mean, only just to respond, that I think it is a really important point to emphasise that even for those earlier periods, we don't fully understand the river records. We have a lot from it, and there are times and places that we do understand very well, but there are an awful lot of times and places I think we understand poorly. And so the broader message to take away is that the river record throughout the Palaeolithic, you know, needs that continued focus, absolutely.
And I think you might argue that obviously the Upper Pal record has been heavily dominated by cave sites as well, which is not something that we've even scratched the surface with some of the earlier Palaeolithic material. There was another question. The mic's coming.
My question is what sort of documents do you imagining is going to, if you like, be available for the planning archaeologists to see a summary of your specialist information? Are we talking about the regional research frameworks or much more detailed individual studies?
In terms of, in
Beccy, do you want to?
Yeah, sorry. You mean in terms of the chalk downland or more generally?
Anywhere, really. I mean, I'm a planning archaeologist in Greater London. I've got half an hour on every case. What can I pick up?
I think the things that would be most helpful to planning archaeologists are things we have to talk about. So where there are shape files marking likely extent of Pleistocene sediments, perhaps things that flag up to look out for this and this being covered within a WSI, the sort of questions you'd expect to be addressed within that. But how that works most effectively within a given situation, of course, is something that we need to have a conversation about, really. But I mean, I saw that as the easiest way to deliver that. To create those shape files for some regions is relatively easily done. For others, we're pretty much working blind, and we don't understand the processes. But the actual point of delivery has to be something that's dictated by the planning archaeologist, because you know what you need to trigger the right sort of response. Does that, yeah?
Yeah, no, yeah. Thank you.
Any more from the floor? Oh, Francis.
Yes, hello, this is following up what Becky was talking about Lurs and Kent. And that is somewhat on the radar already in Kent. And there was the STAR project I did with Historic England and Kent County Council, where we specifically had the agenda of targeting investigation of mapped brick earth deposits. And, you know, we did, considering the acreage of brick earth deposits in Kent, it was a very pinprick investigation. But what we found was there was lots of Devensian deposition, and we were trying to find some older Lurs deposits, and I'm sure they are. They're known to be, for instance, in the Hosfield Valley, apart from anywhere else. But the STAR project report is finished and available online.
Oh,
so anyone wants to look and see, you know, our approach and what we actually found can do so. But back to what you're saying about the lack of opportunity because there's no development. I mean, there is some. There was a lovely one as a place whose name unfortunately escapes me, where there was a big new industrial complex being built right on top of one of prime patch of the Lurs. But what's really important then is that planning archaeologists have mapped Lurs on or mapped Brickearth, because Brickearth covers the last two decennia. There's a lot of potential for different formation processes, different ages of mapped Brickearth. So I don't see everything I'm going to say in my talk now, but geological mapping is valuable because it's the best entry we have into the range of deposits that might contain archaeology. So what you need is planning archaeologists to understand how they can justify investigations of these deposits where there's no known evidence, but we are saying there's potential.
Yeah. Matt.
I guess just follows on to a degree from what Francis was saying, which is, I think head as mapped has become very much kind of a Cinderella of the archaeological deposits. We're very focused on fine-grained Lurs, and we're very focused on fluvial deposits, but the best opportunities for really good preservation, it's part of this kind of fragmenting up into the Upper Pal and Middle Palaeolithic. These two things come together in the lower parts of the river terraces, where actually some of our best preservation is going to be deeply buried under alluvium, and it's going to contain both terrestrial and fluvial archives. So maybe a question I want to ask you is, how regionally, without going into the kind of fine minutiae of mapping, which becomes kind of unworkable on AGR level, can we create kind of characterised deposit models that are available regionally?
I don't know the answer to that, because it's much easier to argue from the detail of what you know up to mapping. And in specific regions, it's obviously going to take quite detailed knowledge of where particular deposits are outcropping, and which may not. It could, you know, the BGS mapping is a great first start, but is only a guide. You know, topography also needs to feed in to that. But I think, presumably, to keep things as simple as possible within particular parts of the landscape, we need fairly broad bits zoned out that say to look for those triggers. I mean, it may be the fact that when you zero in on a particular site, within that broad bit of landscape where it's flagged to consider these issues, that actually that's inapplicable, be that because of previous quarrying, be that because, you know, you've actually got a cutout or something like that. But at least if these are things that, if the geomorphology of a place is thought about at desbase level by somebody who understands those deposits, then, you know, this triggered and caught a lot earlier than it might otherwise be.
Yeah, I think you know, the approach of you can characterise a regional signature for most parts of the world. I mean, one of the things that always surprises me, I've worked in West Sussex for quite a long time, though, is how, when I think I know what's going on, I certainly dig another hole, and I think that's shit. and it can be quite sizable over here. Because, you know, we've discovered stuff on the coastal plain that's moved to Venzian that had no inkling that it was there before. Although you do go back and look at the BGS archives, and then you can actually then go, okay, I can now see that in the record. So, you know, I think it can be the regional approach, but always expect the unexpected. Something else just to throw in the pot. I mean, talking about the models, we've seen the models that Rob will show for the sort of terrace fluvial situation, where I think we've got a big gap in our understanding at the moment is in those very lowest reaches of the river valleys, in the lower Thames, downstream of Dave's model, in the lower mainway, particularly the area from Chatham down to the coast, where I think the accepted models completely break down, and the distribution of glacial deposits in relationship to buried gravel deposits is quite
behind. Oh, John, here we go.
I said I wasn't a Palaeolithic specialist, so please excuse my ignorance, Nick. But the Haysborough stuff, anybody. I remember John Wyman getting out and saying categorically there was no material from those deposits, and actually they've been searched extensively for a heck of a long time by collectors. And then all of a sudden this stuff turns up, and I just wonder, talking about mapping and modelling deposits, I think is crucial. But I think it is also, we've also got to recognise that they're actually finding human occupation signs in a very sparsely occupied landscape is like looking for a needle in a haystack. And I know I've looked for that needle in West London and the Latin Stone Complex for quite a while, and only found it by complete accident in a late Bronze Age feature. So when I looked for it, I didn't find it, and then a few flakes turned up. So you know, it's an extreme, if you model it all, it is extremely difficult. It takes a hell of a lot of search. You know. So that's concrete.
Yeah, exactly right. And I think it's applicable not just to Haysborough, I think other areas, as you suggest. And just as an illustration, 400 square metres of excavation produce 80 artefacts. All of that was sieved. So it's only by looking very, very hard that you'll find in these sites. And I think we have to build that into any, you know, future work that we do, not just at Haysborough, but at other sites as well. A sort of related thing going to Rob's rivers. I remember, I'm sure numerous people here have undertaken sieving programs of large quantities of gravel. Certainly Francis over there has probably done more than anybody else in the room, and done my own as well. And artifacts are extremely rare. There was a site, what was the name of the site, Simon? Mary St. Chadwell. Chadwell St. Mary, where we sieved something like 12 tons of gravel. We knew this is Boyne Hill sediments, I think, or Boyne Hill sediments, and I think a single artifact was found as a surface find, but nothing within the sieved gravel. So what's that telling us? You know, what are we trying to find? What are we looking for? And related to what Beccy was saying, you know, how hard do we have to look to find these upland sites or plateau sites? How, you know, the distribution of archaeology is going to be critical to our success at finding these things, and therefore we have to have strategies that effectively say yes, there are artifacts here, or give a more positive, stronger negative, no, there aren't any artifacts here. And I think that's a really important issue to address, and equally so with the, you know, some of the Upper Palaeolithic sites, particularly the early Upper Palaeolithic sites, you know, where artifacts are extremely rare. So I think that's an issue for all these different areas.
Mark at the first, yep.
Thanks. Following on what Nick was saying there about the distribution, it's not just the distribution of Pleistocene sediments, it's the distribution of artifacts within them, and understanding the past geography of those systems, particularly fluvial, but equally with the dolmen sequences that Beccy was explaining. From personal experience with both both contexts, I mean, I was dragged around for much of the 1990s and early 2000s to some godforsaken pits with Dave Bridgeland, where, you know, we dug sections that you wouldn't really want to do, I wouldn't want to do now, and found absolutely nothing. And then, I mean, when we went back to the archive and had a look at these things, the museum collections have sometimes got hundreds, if not thousands, of artifacts. And when you go and look at the original descriptions, for example, I'm thinking of Sturry here, Beccy, you'll remember the details better than I will, but Ince mentioned something like 16 artifacts per 10 cubic yards, you know, which is a lot more than we're going to be excavating in a few days section cutting. With regards to the dolmen sites, I like your DEM, which seems to show lots of holes. I'd be interested to find out how many of those are bomb craters.
It's just off the LIDAR. Interestingly, for Kent in particular, they've mapped where the V2s came down and the V1s, but there's nothing more general, or it's still just on paper records for bomb craters.
Because
as
our experience, in Westcliff showed, there was a visible solution feature on the surface, but that was a red herring. And that the actual, so it was solution front, and it was highlighting the fact that there was a solution front there, but the actual Pleistocene, lower Palaeolithic in this case, Doline, was tens if not hundreds of metres away. So you're looking for solution fronts, and then you've got to do, I think, what Matt and Beccy have done in Jersey, which is actually start out, well, this is our starting point, and where's it come from? And Matt's landscape approach, I think, is a starting point to that. Can you say anything about that? No.
Just in terms of the Dolines and where they tend to appear in the landscape, there are commonalities and places where they tend to form. So those uvulae, the big collections of Dolines, tend to crop out on the edge of a chalk valley above the water table, basically. So modelling that, yeah, room full of people. Yeah, you can model broadly those places in the landscape as the sort of place where you're likely to have capture potential. So it's those sort of drawing together, understanding the landscape better and drawing together that broad confluence of circumstances and just flagging up that that's somewhere to check for capture.
The biggest problem with all of these sites, though, is the fact that they rarely have organic preservation. So we're stuck in a situation where we've got all of these very interesting sites at the top of the hill floating in a sort of half a million years of ether.
Unless you've got an equivalent of, or unless you can start tying it into the regional LERS stratigraphy, in which case then you do start to have very detailed control on where in glacial interglacial cycles you're dealing with.
There was a question at the back, and then Francis again, so, yep. James.
I think just in terms of, we're looking at sort of trying to find a practical solution of going from everything that people are saying in terms of how that then feeds into perhaps the planning process and how we can flag this up. I think a greater use of GIS in terms of taking it from the landscape down to the site detail would be really good. So we can plug in and set parameters for different regions for based on geology, elevation, you know, whatever kind of thing that you can imagine that you might like to flag. Set those parameters, and anyone in then sort of a regional sort of county office or city office, and then just plug all those parameters into GIS and run those things and kind of help model exactly where we might look for things. So perhaps what we need then is sort of just more of that discussion between us who use GIS and all that kind of modelling regularly in our sort of day-to-day research life, and then linking in the HER record on a bit more of a practical level. Do you think that might be a possible aid in this, or is it already happening? Sort of a bit more
in
a proactive role.
Rob, or Beccy, either of you.
I mean, yeah, we'll come back. But I was going to say, obviously that's something that would be great, but actually I think you probably need something much, much simpler at the interface. You know, you don't want to be having to train people in the HERs who are totally overstretched at the moment how to run complicated queries into which sort of you just want to flag up, you know, particular spots and particular it's just putting simple shapefiles on derived from understanding of landscape that just flag those factors to be considered, I think. But you need to do a small thing.
I mean, my main concern there, James, just is what you're outlining is just the staggering quantity of work that involves. I think it's a great idea, and it came to mind because of the recent completion of the projects up in Worcester where they've done a lot of this GIS enhancement. Now that is a relatively small body of data that they've been dealing with, but I know they've commented at just the level of work that has involved. And so that, and my concern, I suppose, with these kinds of IT-driven solutions is how quickly the IT shifts, and that we can start projects, and before we finish those projects, potentially it's moved on in a way that what we produce may not always be that useful anymore, even though when we set out, it was very useful. And that doesn't mean we shouldn't do it, but I think we do need to think really carefully about how those sorts of IT projects are going to work, the scale at which they can work.
I was just wondering if sort of like the ultimate querying power of GIS within that actually is a way to streamline that process. So it is fairly simple. It's just, you know, the parameters, but of course the restrictions around it are that you're going to miss a key parameter, I guess. So.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think you're absolutely right. I think some of that automated querying ability is hugely valuable. I think maybe the big challenge is getting the data in is the big headache. But
and also, what systems are people already working with? And, you know, how does that sort of work with exegesis or something like that rather than, you know, whatever you're running? I mean, that conversation has to be had with planning archaeologists about what we can deliver to them. Not us coming up with an all-singing, all-dancing research solution that is never going to work in practice, I think.
If I'm allowed to hog the mic for a moment, I mean, it was clear from a number of the comments that have been made that we've all had experience of examples on allegedly, well, not allegedly, that's not fair, rich sites, but where actually the volumetric density of artifacts in these rich sites is perhaps much less than we might think. And it does, I think, highlight the need for us to reflect on what do we mean by success and failure. That I think in some investigations, not finding artifacts, it's not failure, because the Palaeolithic record is this much broader body of evidence, its sediments, its biology, and that there are lots of circumstances in which, particularly some of these older deposits that have yielded a lot of material in the past, if we can go back, do targeted work, contextualise those old collections, that is critical. And whether one finds another couple of hand axes along the way, or another couple of, just to be inclusive, Upper Palaeolithic bladey things. Sorry. Then, you know, okay. You know, it's that other evidence which I think sometimes is critical. You know, there are contexts in which that's what is important and that can be a measure of success.
Nick, do you want to come in on that? Because I think there's, you know, there's some interesting comments to be made possibly with the records that you've been working on as well in terms of looking for things, how hard you have to work to get that.
Yeah, I mean, it's really what I was saying before, I think, that, you know, I think we have to have, Rob's absolutely right, you know, what is success, what is failure? We have to have systems that properly answer that question. And, you know, there is no such thing as failure, because nearly always we're finding other evidence that is contributing to the much larger picture, whether it be environmental evidence, understanding of sediments, and so on. But from the planning point of view, you know, if there's a watching brief, if there's a programme of investigation, we need to be absolutely sure that we've got the systems in place that are really answering the question, you know, are there artefacts here, or, you know, are we simply not looking hard enough? And I think, you know, really need to take this on board when we're looking at the planning process.
Francis, then Matt.
I'll ask your mind back to what Nick was saying 5 minutes ago, which I was going to full circle to say a point again. I think there's a couple of points to raise. Firstly, there's a general structural difficulty for cladding archaeologists and the Palaeolithic in dealing with stuff that is very rare, that's important when you find it. And I haven't really got a very constructive answer to that, other than just recognise that it's a problem. But in terms of stuff and gravels, I was organising a seminar with Rob about 15 years ago, and quite up there about the seminal site of Dunbridge, which is, you know, stimulated the whole Seven Rivers Project thing. Very, very rich historical site, loads of test pits, and nothing in them. So I think this actually means that maybe we need to rethink how we think of gravels. It's not just a homogenous mass of disturbed stuff. It's a deposit that might contain isolated concentrations, and we need to think of them as sites. So we need to think about evaluating our fluvial gravel terrace archive, and disregarding the importance of other aspects, as a landscape where there may be big areas and not very much, but concentrations of something in some places, and that's a way into considering how we approach it. Then just to finally follow up James's point, which he absolutely made before I had a chance to have another go with the mic,
This is something I've suggested specifically. I've done quite a lot of work in Kent, drawing lines on maps, which I know is what planning archaeologists want, defining areas of character and potential. And it's fundamentally an expert business. You pore over the geology, you look at the topography, you guess where geological deposits will continue, you look at the historical record of where stuff has been found, and you come up with your expert assessment of areas of higher potential. And what I've proposed is to try and develop the more algorithmic approach, which sort of second guesses the expert analysis and see how the results compare and try and build towards a more effective algorithmic approach. And that's something certainly I'd like to be involved in doing.
I think what a lot of these points are highlighting, especially in the planning process, is just how much inherent risk there is in just dealing with the HER as a distribution of fine spots, even with the qualification of putting in deposit models. You know, a good kind of Upper Paleolithic and Holocene example was Oxford's work carried out in East Sussex by Mike McDonnelly, where, you know, we've got big gaps on the map that produced entire late glacial and early Holocene landscapes with multiple sites. As Martin said, you know, even when you've got expertise, even when you know a landscape, the chances of surprises coming up is huge. If we scale that up nationally with the big differences in the HER, those areas that haven't had HER reviews, and we put that against maybe, you know, half an hour, or even a couple of hours in putting together a WSI or a desktop assessment, there's a lot of risk there. We could test algorithmic models and see if they work with expertise, but until we've got that in place, where do we get the expertise into the planning process right at the beginning in a way that isn't onerous on clients and isn't onerous in time on hard-pressed HERs? And I'm just wondering whether we need to have better networks of the expertise that sits across commercial research archaeology to get that expertise in at an early stage, so we're not relying on dots on maps.
Clive.
Thank you. It was, I think to come back to some fundamental issues here which paleolithic archaeologists and those concerned with the planning process will always wrestle. I mean, just to come back to the theme of this particular discussion about how well do we understand the record, let's just broaden it out a little bit for a moment. I think as all three speakers showed, we have actually, I mean, let's just give ourselves a pat on the back for a moment. We've actually made some huge leaps forward. I mean, when John Wymer was doing Southern Rivers and then English Rivers, it really was kind of pinning the tail on the donkey with putting fine spots onto those BGS maps and so on. And it was sort of early Bridgeland in those days for the terrace sequences. We didn't know anything about the Norfolk coasts, and nobody was really looking at plateau areas. You know, we've come a huge way forward in that, and the archaeological science that now underpins all that, particularly in terms of dating and the biostratigraphy environments, is just huge. And so we have moved forward. If you take it back 30 years before John started that work, I mean, it really was the Dark Ages. We didn't even have an idea about really what we were looking at. So we've come a long way, but what we've now got to the point of, though, is realizing that there's still much that we don't understand. And part of that is because of just the sheer difficulties of obtaining representative samples from these various deposit blocks, which all three speakers talked about. And I'm sure we'll come back to that in the later sessions and broaden that discussion that way. But what I'd just quite like to do, Nick had one final bullet point, which he didn't talk about, which was new worlds waiting to be discovered.
Okay.
And I think it's important to just remind ourselves just how fantastic this archaeological record is. and why it has been taken seriously by English Heritage and Historic England and by the planning process generally. And where it's been successful, it has repaid enormously. I mean, Nick, for example, has managed to double the length of the archaeological record in this country, which is, you know, no mean feat, really.
With many colleagues.
It may only involve 80 artefacts, but, you know, they are 80 very important artefacts. So I'd just like to tease out from Nick and the other speakers what these new worlds waiting to be discovered might be, and how that is actually going to contribute to the kind of intellectual excitement of British archaeology.
Yeah, I think it's not just British archaeology. I think we can go further than that. I mean, the whole of the Cromer forest bed, it's an amazingly rich series of sediments that covers 1.5 million years, possibly even longer. And we do have easy exposure to these sediments. You know, on a go down to a beach anywhere along that coast and you'll encounter somewhere the forest bed. And in the past, you know, John Wymer made the claim 20 years ago or whatever it was that, you know, there is no archaeology in these sediments and people had been looking for 200 years. So we have to find better ways of studying those series of sediments. We have to also understand, you know, how the chronology works within those sediments and therefore the more likely places to look. And, you know, Simon Parfitt and Richard Priest have been doing fantastic work, and Jonathan Lee as well, fantastic work on that front. So, you know, that's one way forward, that we really have to understand how those sediments work together. That'll give us some sort of insight into where to look and find ways of... We've had a certain amount of success at Haysborough. It's been very costly, it's been very hard work, and it's not easy work either. So, you know, do we want to invest heavily in that type of work in the future? You've also got the offshore record, of course, and, you know, we're getting better and better at looking at that record, but again, it's not easy. The potential for those sediments is immense. It's not just putting the human record further back in time, but it's providing an environmental context for human presence. And, you know, these have got to be some of the most important questions globally. Where are the frontiers of human presence? How does that change through time? Northern Europe, we have the benefit of probably the earliest humans in northern environments anywhere around the globe. And so understanding that frontier, we have the tools to understand that frontier. So I think that's got to be a question. And how that relates to human adaptation, you know, either physical adaptation or the development of new technologies to cope with long, cold winters. In the case of Haysborough, similar to northern Germany or southern Sweden, how on earth were they doing it? We had a meeting the other day with Rob Hosfield, a new initiative, and, you know, this is certainly for me one of the main interesting questions for the next decade. Does that answer your question, Clive?
I think it'd be handy also if Rob and Beccy are happy to answer that in terms of where the next big step change will come. What do you dream of from your individual records, whether it's rivers or plateaus?
But from the, I don't know, I guess I dream of northern France, but it would be we know that we have similar sorts of capture points. We know that we have similar quantities of artifacts coming from these sorts of upland locale. We know that in individual cases, so thinking of Caddington and the Chiltern sites in particular, we know we have extensive refitting. Where I'd like to go with this is start to put together the fluvial record, looking from the site level in detail in terms of what you can see people are doing at particular places in the landscape to the upland, and start to build up patterns of land use throughout the landscape, not in one particular place. But this not to be, you know, simply focused on northeast Kent or the Chilterns or Alton in Hampshire or anything like that, but for this to be part of a joined up thinking about the record of Northwest Europe and particularly across the Channel with these contiguous landscapes that currently, you know, we don't have a harmonised record, but there are ways of bringing this together. And I think there are disharmonies in the record as well that look like difference that actually doing this sort of base level work will help us address. So in northern France, you know, you have a lot of sites that date to stage six. We have no human occupation, you know, bar a couple of bits going into stage six. Is that a real pattern? Is that just that we're not looking in the right sort of place? Or does this tell us something about human adaptation, changing adaptation, and where people can actually occupy in the landscape, and how does that change over time? And I think, yeah, these are the things that excite me, really.
Yeah, I should start by saying that the project that Nick referred to is myself and James Cole, and I stress that as he's here in the audience in particular. I think what I would like to see is, in terms of moving forward, is actually a more, in terms of the rivers particularly, a more nuanced appreciation of what these riverine landscapes were like. I think because they've produced, certainly for particularly for earlier periods, so much of our archaeology, I'm not sure at times we fully acknowledge perhaps what living in them was like, the whole sort of life on the ground idea. As one or two colleagues who are here will know, I spent bits of the early 2000s blundering around a Welsh river floodplain just outside Aberystwyth, thinking about artifact dispersal patterns, and loaded down, admittedly, as I was, with total stations and all the rest, the number of times I fell over and fell in unexpected holes in the floodplain. And I remember myself and my companion at the time, Jenny Chambers, who was doing the work with me, we just looked at each other and said, thank goodness there's not a spotted hyena or something out here, because we'd have long since been eaten. And I think at times we're not terribly good. We reconstruct these beautiful, beautiful Pleistocene habitats and environments. I think we could do a little bit more to think about, what does it actually mean to live in them? What are they really like? And I still think there's a little bit of a tendency for us to sort of look down on them from above and say, well, there was woodland here and there was grassland here and these are the sorts of animals. And you think, okay, stop looking at it from above in a sort of rather godlike way. Stick yourself down there. What's it actually like? And I think on that sort of broader theme, perhaps, of the ecology of living and of survival, I do think that a really exciting area of development is in the late Upper Paleolithic, the late glacial, where we've got this wonderful, wonderfully detailed evidence for climatic change, for climatic variability. And I think it's a fantastic test case for appreciating how, in this case, Homo sapiens, as a hunter-gatherer, responds to those dynamic, significant changes. I remember sitting in classes, listening to Clive, and he would show me a climate curve, and it was big. It was like a sort of Big Dipper, you know, and it was cold here and it was warm there, and then it was cold again. And he thought, oh, okay, very good, very good. Now, every time I look at those climate curves, and there they are oscillating up and down, you know, these dramatic, relatively short-term changes, what does that mean if you're living? You know, what does that mean for Paleolithic humans? Do they kind of go, I'm going to tough it out? And then when it gets really unpleasant, they fall over. You know, do they subtly respond to changes in ways that half of us, because we all spend most of our time in offices, have forgotten about? You know, when they respond to these subtle environmental cues and they move somewhere else, they do something different. I think these are really big, exciting questions. And it's the same thing in a different way that Nick was picking up on. How do humans in the past cope with climate change? And I think all of our records increasingly give us a way to think about those experiences.
That's right. Did you have something to add?
Yeah, following on from what Rob was saying there, Paul and I discussed in the British Paleolithic, and it was something that came also out of the Jersey conference, several things that have been mentioned today. The first is Becky's point, or was it Rob's? I can't remember, that most of the places we dig are all the same place. This is kind of the normal environment that
that we're talking about there, which is probably why we rarely find anything like a base camp, should they have existed or not. Let's not go there. The other point I think I need to make is the fact that I've noticed a particular scalar problem between humans and their environments. And that is that the resolution of our environmental reconstructions, of course, go from Milankovitch scales right down to pods worth of beetles, where Russell used to be able to tell you what was going on the Tuesday afternoon. Okay, now we've got those scales of resolution, and there's a continuum in between. But we have a problem with humans. And Rob, I'm sorry to disagree with you, but I think that when we're dealing with climate change and with environmental change, we perceive a human that lives for 50,000 years, and they don't. They live for 25 and then they die. And that I don't think that any one human, save perhaps in the most extreme Damsgaard-Oeschger events, experience climate change in a lived sense.
But in those dramatic shifts, I think it's an interesting possibility. And I'm always struck that with some of that really high resolution climate change, we're occasionally told, you know, it's shifting by 10 degrees. Now, year on year at the moment, we're told, oh, it's half a degree warmer this year. I think we notice.
Not in Durham, you don't, mate.
That's a fair comment. You mean it's that shift from cold to even colder?
Okay, John.
Just a couple of comments. One is on the GIS issue of HGRs. I used to be a HGR compiler a long time ago, and they're called SMRs. And my experience is that HGRs in those days, SMRs, used to contain a lot of data, but not much information. Now with GIS, we do now actually have the opportunity to turn data into information. But what's even more important is actually to have a human process to turn information into knowledge. And suddenly, what we'll be talking about is actually how you capture and develop and interrogate and further knowledge. And that knowledge has to be pitched at the level of the general public. Because it's, you know, if Palaeolithic archaeology wants to get support for the things you've been doing, you actually have to enthuse the public, because it's the public who pays in one way or the other, either through development or through research grants or whatever you're doing. And the sort of questions we've been talking about now, about Nick talking about, you know, did they have clothes, how did they survive? Rob talking about, yeah, what sort of environments were these people in? You know, you've got reality shows, people trapped on an island to try and survive. It's damn hard. What would it have been like, you know, 10,000, 20,000, 50,000 years ago? These are questions actually that the public actually really enjoy and really like. They ask you, what did they have fire? How did they make their parkas? You know, what are they doing with these bits around? Those are the sorts of things that actually we, I think, as archaeologists, go and engage with. And the other thing is, don't forget, as Palaeolithic archaeologists, all the other archaeologists from all the other periods are members of the public as well. Okay? That's not the other part of the thing.
Wise words. Does anyone want to respond on that? Not signing up for a game show anytime soon. No?
Too cold.
Okay. Yes, right at the back.
So just a little comment on the rivers and maps and GIS. There are some really good maps out there now, because some of the others that big maps of all of Europe with sea levels at the right level, with the links, rivers linking regions across the borders, and making, say, national archaeologies that are changing the climate. It'd be nice to see for all periods these type of maps, whenever we're talking about the archaeology, not just the channel river, but the channel separating things as well. And I don't know if you would envision a way of doing it this framework in the future.
Are we becoming anti fine spot on maps, though?
The data is the data, so fine spots are what we have. It's what those fine spots mean, and not giving those fine spots equal weight. So when you're simply plotting stuff along rivers in one area as we pretty much end up doing in a lot of Britain, versus when you look at the distribution of French sites, for instance, those tend not to be find spots, but to be sites, excavated and dated sites. You very rarely see a map of all the Palaeolithic find spots in northern France. So there's a, you know, there's a disjunct between what we're actually seeing, which I think makes it difficult to put them together at the moment, because we're actually not talking about the same sort of distribution. And I think that's something that we need to work together more to actually harmonise what we're seeing.
I'd just like to ask Beccy a question, which I wrote down ages ago. Right, you've got your plateau sites, your upland sites. Where, first of all, are the dough lines just capture points, or are they actually attracted to people and therefore you get archaeology alongside them? If not, and you've got a sort of general spread of archaeology, of archaeological sites here, there and everywhere, what's happening to it? Where's it going? Where's it ending up? Which relates to dots on maps, because there is a way into this in terms of, you know, field walking programmes and all kinds of different ways of assessing it.
Yeah, and is something that is regionally very, very different. So somewhere like East Kent, where you've got a very, very active local group who are keyed into looking for the Palaeolithic record of the Downs, you actually get quite good mapping of where stuff is and isn't occurring, as long as Jeff Halliwell can drive there in his car and it's not too far from his house, sort of thing. Or Peter Harp's work, sort of, over in Surrey, you get a similar sort of, you know, very good individual snapshot of the spread of material across the landscape. In terms of whether these locations are acting as a magnet and not simply as a capture point of material that would be just blanket spread across the landscape, we've done very, very little work on the record of this country to actually really answer that question, and to know what people are doing there. But when you look at the continental record, you know, people are extracting raw material, intact napping scatters within dough lines, sometimes stretched as the dough line has continued to subside. You know, you've got very, very detailed information and suggestions that these are acting as magnet locations, that they're located at particular points in the landscape, often on plateau edges, that give you good views out into the landscape, as well as raw material being available. So it's sort of a bit of both. But we can't just import a pattern that we're seeing elsewhere onto a record that currently, you know, we just know where there are find spots, and we don't actually know a lot about the capture, the date, the environment, or any of those things, all of which are questions that we could address.
Okay. Right. Okay. Well, I had several questions that I was going to ask our speakers in case you all turned out to be mute, but actually you've been fantastic with coming forward with questions and stimulating debate, so thank you to you. We're going to pause now for a short break, so there will be coffee served in the Wheeler Room, that where we started, and we'll reconvene afterwards, but please join me in thanking our speakers for the first session this morning.